So radicalism, extremism, what else do they call it? All sorts of words that they use. You know, all these words have a particular genealogy, right? What we mean by genealogy means they came from somewhere. They didn't come out of a vacuum, right? They weren't like in the Quran or in the Sunnah and then extrapolated and people use them, but rather they came out of a particular understanding, a particular context. And the idea, if we just took the meaning, not the words, the idea that what are meant to be pristine religious teachings from whatever religion they are, whether it be Islam, whether it be Christianity, whether it be Judaism, even Buddhism, taken and manipulated in a manner to further a particular agenda, whether it be a political agenda, perhaps a personal one, that's something as old as religion itself, right? So it's not a new concept, if we take that meaning. However, the meanings that are applied today, the idea of radicalism, extremism, for many Muslims, including myself, the term is a little bit uncomfortable because there are certain implications about where those terms came from. So if you have radicalism, extremism, right, and that's kind of juxtaposed with moderate Islam, right, or moderation. You can scour the Islamic text for something called moderate Islam, and you won't find it. We don't use that word, right, because moderate means to do something in moderation, to do it kind of, I would say, even half-heartedly, or in a manner that is not at the full extent possible. And what I fear is that this particular understanding, many Muslims are adopting it, right? And I think many of our parents, our elder generation, who may not be in the room with us today, but I think they feel this way, is that they have sort of apprehension about their children getting too religious, right? Because if you get too religious, then you won't be moderate anymore, and then you might fall into extremism. So there's this kind of general notion around that, you know, practice your religion kind of, you know, a little bit because you don't want to go too far, right? And I think many people are even uncomfortable when they hear things like we have certain criminal punishments that the Sharia advocates. We have certain rules and regulations pertaining to gender relations or the separation of the sexes and things like this. So people tend to associate with all of that, that if you go too far, right, then you put yourself kind of in a box in this place where much of the things that people enjoy about life or much of the things that people like to participate in life will no longer be available to them. And I think it's a vicious cycle. So what I wanted to kind of talk about a little bit is the idea of religious teachings being manipulated based upon misconceptions is something even the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke about. So I want to take it a step away from what modern security services would define as radicalism or extremism, right? And I've had the opportunity to sit with some of these people at length and discuss their views versus our views. And the one thing that I came away with is they're kind of very singularly focused on a particular thing. And they're only going to work within the cognitive frames of what they're used to, what they're accustomed to. So they have a particular background, and they're not really going to go outside of that background, right? And if you attended our lecture last week, I'm not going to say the same things again, but we spoke a little bit about how the current sort of cultural paradigm that we're living in has much to do with what happened over the past 200, 250 years since the time of the Enlightenment. And so most people are thinking in that frame. Most people are thinking that if you follow religion, there's a thing called following religion blindly, and if you follow religion blindly, then more often than not, by definition, you'll be an intolerant person, and you'll be a person who doesn't really engage with the greater culture around them. And you might be a type of person who prefers isolation and segregation rather than to integration and engagement. So these are all the things they're thinking about, you know, these counter-extremist operatives or security services, when they're thinking, when they're talking to a religious person. Not everybody, we can't generalize, but I think more often than not, this is kind of the frame that they're thinking. So what they want to hear is sort of like, okay, you guys are Muslim, but you know, you're Australian, right? Or you're American, or you're British, or you're French, or you're Belgian, and you know, you have to engage, you know, as the Prime Minister of England says, or of the UK, British values, right? American values. I remember when that young California man who, Johnny Walker, I think was his name, he went to Afghanistan. He was captured there, he was brought back, and the Attorney General at the time for George Bush, John Ashcroft, said that he was a traitor, right? Not just to his country, but to his culture, right? Because here's a white American who embraces Islam and takes on the garb of what they seem, of what they say is the enemy, right? So they had the Afghani hat and had the sarwal qamis and the whole Afghani outfit, which is the face of the enemy. So they see it within that frame, right? And in America, more than any place else, there's religious undertones. So Bush and others used the words like "we're on a crusade" and things like this that were, you know, later interpreted as faux pas and as missteps. But you get the general sense that this is the way these people are thinking. So with that aside, right, because the counter to that is many Muslims then feel threatened and say, well, look at all the injustices that's happening, right? Look at, you know, Obama can talk about people not insulting Muslims till he's blue in the face, but how many Muslim countries has he bombed while he's been the president? How many drone strikes have there been on wedding parties in Afghanistan or in Yemen or in any of the countries where all these things are going on? And obviously, these are serious issues, right? And these are things that people think about when we start talking about extremism versus moderation and so forth. So there's kind of this push from both sides. On the one side, you do have the government entities and all the security apparatus that goes along with that, that are pushing in a certain direction, certain interpretation. And then the reaction on the other side from many Muslims themselves, who see that even some of these acts that happened, like in Jakarta yesterday, or like in Istanbul, or California, San Bernardino a few weeks ago, and so forth, not that they're justified, but there is kind of maybe an understanding of why these things continue to happen because of what's happening with many of these governments, right? And then when you go to the word terrorism, and you define, which is a loosely defined term, and then you say it's, you know, a manner by which certain political results can be brought about via violence, via killing, right? If you go by that loose term, then many governments engage in terrorism, right? Certainly the Israeli government engages in terrorism. Certainly the US government engages in forms of terrorism. And in fact, there was a study that was sanctioned, I believe, by the Pentagon, if I'm not mistaken, in the 80s, where they tried to define the word terrorism, and they abandoned it, because they found that if they adopted that definition, then many states, including the US, would fall under the practice of terrorism. So while we're not denying all of that, and that's kind of informs the conversation, again, what I want to draw your attention to tonight is that within our own tradition, right, within our own intellectual genealogy, within our own understanding, we do believe that religious texts can be misinterpreted and can be purposefully misinterpreted to further certain agendas. And so it's my belief that if we are going to get rid of the scourge of terrorism, extremism, but it's not important the word that we use, then it's going to come more or less from within us, as it has in the past. Right, as it has in the past. So this is not something new, as I mentioned. Throughout our history, we have seen certain groups form that want to advance particular agendas, and then they further these interpretations and cause much strife. The only difference perhaps now is that we may not have the institutional power and fortitude to counter it as much as we had in the past. And the nature of the modern world is that it doesn't actually take that much in terms of numbers, and in terms of material and economic strength, to actually have a misaligned interpretation and advance it. All you need is, you know, Google account, internet line, a couple of flashy videos, and voila, you have like a following. That's an oversimplification, obviously, but it's much easier to do that today.